I once worked for a guy who literally banned all his subordinate managers, including me, from ever using the phrase, "we're getting there." He was one of those pedantic sticklers who would only accept a specific completion date for any given task, so that he could hold you fully to account each time you sailed past that date without having achieved your goal. I did quite well, I lasted 3 months in that job. Anyway, I mentioned that little anecdote because today's video is the second of our 2024 Green Tech Progress Reviews, and the green tech we're reviewing today is solid-state batteries. The developers of this particular technology have used the phrase "we're getting there" so often since my first video on the subject back in 2018 that you could be forgiven for thinking that we are in fact not getting there at all. So is it time to give up on yet another green technology pipe dream? Or are we nearly there yet? Hello and welcome to Just Ever Think. We've investigated solid-state batteries on no fewer than three separate occasions on this channel over the last 5 years or so. It's one of those extremely compelling technologies that if it ever does hit mainstream mass production at an affordable price, really will revolutionise just about every sector of energy consumption for folks like you and me, most notably, of course, in the transport sector, where solid-state technology promises significantly higher energy density than current lithium-ion batteries, with ultra-fast charging times and much longer operational lifetimes. For the benefit of anyone who's had better things to do for the last 5 years or so, here's a quick recap of how it all works. In a normal lithium-ion battery, like the one we looked at in last week's video, you typically find a cathode made of a lithium-based material like lithium nickel manganese oxide, for example, which is your NMC battery, and an anode, typically made of graphite. Surrounding all that is a liquid electrolyte, usually made by adding lithium salts into a fairly nasty flammable solvent. To stop the whole thing short-circuiting, you have a separator membrane in the middle of the electrolyte that will only allow ions to pass through. When you charge the system up, lithium ions rush across the liquid electrolyte from the cathode side, energized by the electricity flowing from the charging device. Those charged particles just happen to be small enough to be captured within the lattice-like structure of graphite in a process called intercalation. As the battery discharges, the ions flow back across to the cathode, and electrons flow back through an external circuit to do their useful work. And that's fine. In fact, it works really nicely for myriad applications, from very small stuff like smartwatches and phones, all the way up to very large stationary energy storage installations on electricity grids. But then old Elon came along, didn't he? And he started putting lithium-ion batteries into attractive-looking cars that people actually wanted to buy. The Tesla brand has turned the automotive industry completely on its head in the space of only a few short years. And now every auto manufacturer in the world is scrambling to get their ducks in a row before switching off all their internal combustion engine production lines sometime in the next decade or so. As a result, a concept that was essentially first proposed by Michael Faraday back in the early 19th century has suddenly come hurtling back into vogue in the laboratories of battery chemists all over the planet, because it offers what most tech journalists, including this one, usually refer to as the holy grail of battery cell technology. Rightly or wrongly, one of the biggest perceived objections among prospective new electric vehicle buyers is the dreaded range anxiety. So the alleviation of this, not really a real problem, has become something of an obsession for all the major car makers, who are either making their batteries absolutely mahoosive, which strikes me as a rather self-defeating exercise, or who are looking for ways to produce batteries that can receive and deliver energy far more efficiently. Which brings us to solid-state technology. For the purposes of this video, I'm going to ignore the so-called thin-film solid-state cells, which only store a very small amount of energy, but which can last for a very, very long time, and are already in use in things like pacemakers and IoT devices. And instead, I'll be focusing on what are known as solid-state bulk batteries, which can store a lot of energy, and are what the EV developers are all interested in. There are currently dozens of different types of solid-state bulk batteries in development all over the world, far too many to go through individually in a single video. But the basic theory, at least as far as this somewhat limited layman can understand, goes like this. The solid in solid state refers to the electrolyte, as you've no doubt already worked out for yourself. So why is that good then? Well, it means that in theory, if you can find a solid material like a ceramic or a glass or a solid polymer that lets ions through but that also effectively acts as a separator between anode and cathode, then you can get rid of the liquid electrolyte, reduce the volume of the cell, and effectively increase its energy density. You also theoretically eradicate the rather inconvenient problem of dendrite growth that presents a potential fire risk in current lithium-ion batteries. And because you get rid of the flammable solvents that liquid electrolytes are based on, your battery can now withstand far higher temperatures, which means you can really whack the charge in at a truly terrifying rate without causing any damage to the cell. But that's not all. Oh no! It turns out that solid-state batteries may also facilitate the use of lithium metal anodes. So why is that useful? Well, apparently, if you can ditch the graphite anode and replace it with lithium metal, then you potentially get yourself even more energy density. Folks at BMW recently published this chart of test data based on 12 different next-generation cathode materials, shown along the x-axis at the bottom here, and three different anode materials. You can see that changing the cathode doesn't do a whole lot to the energy density when combined with graphite or graphite silicon anodes. But as soon as you combine them with a lithium metal anode, the performance jumps right up, almost doubling the best graphite silicon energy density. And here's some more ham-fisted science by yours truly to try and explain why that is. Essentially, the clever science bods tell us that if you're storing your lithium in a carbon-based material, then it takes 6 carbon atoms to hold on to one lithium ion. But if you use an anode made of pure metallic lithium, then you effectively do away with all that bulky carbon and get yourself an even lighter, even more energy-dense battery cell. The only slight snag, apart from the obvious worry about global supplies of lithium, is that lithium metal anodes are really, really good at building up those pesky dendrites that I mentioned earlier, which means they just don't work in lithium-ion batteries with liquid electrolytes. But if you can make a solid electrolyte robust enough to resist the growth of dendrites while doing all the other stuff that you want it to do, then you've surely hit the jackpot, haven't you? Which is why developers have been trying to find that solid material for the last 4 decades or so. And that brings us rather neatly to a US startup called QuantumScape, which is a name that I'm quite sure most of you good folks out there will already know well. They are arguably one of the most vocal and most talked about solid state developers in the industry. And I think it's fair to say that they've had a bit of a roller coaster ride since their inception back in 2010. Just to really confuse the issue, they're working on something called a semi-solid state battery. There's no anode at all in their system. Instead, you get a lithium-based cathode with an electrical contact below it, and a solid-state ceramic separator with an electrical contact above it. As the battery charges, lithium moves out of the cathode through the atomic lattice of the non-porous ceramic separator and deposits between the top of the separator and the upper electrical contact, effectively forming a new anode layer of pure metallic lithium. So as this QuantumScape animation suggests, you get the same energy from a much smaller space compared to the standard lithium-ion setup on the left-hand side there. Now, here's where the semi-solid bit comes in. According to their own website's FAQ page, QuantumScape couples this solid-state ceramic separator with an organic liquid electrolyte for the cathode. The cathode requires high conductivity, high voltage stability, and the ability to make good contact with the cathode active material particle. It is difficult to find materials that meet both these requirements, and attempts to do so often result in a material that meets neither requirement well. QuantumScape's original sales pitch, which is presumably what pulled in $300 million of investment from Volkswagen, was that their technology would result in a 50 to 80% increase in the driving range of an electric vehicle, which translated to an increase from 350 miles to as much as 630 miles from the same sized battery pack. Despite some encouraging recent feedback from VW's subsidiary battery testing company, PowerCo, QuantumScape has struggled to achieve these numbers or to ramp up its technology to real-world production volumes. So it's had to do a bit of expectation management in recent months. Its website now quotes a vehicle range improvement of between 14 and 43%, which takes a 350 mile range battery up to somewhere between 400 and 500 miles. A regulatory filing made by QuantumScape in October 2023 to the US Securities and Exchange Commission clarified that the company had missed the commercialization milestones outlined in its deal with VW, and that the German automaker therefore had the right to terminate the joint venture if it chose to do so. And sure enough, according to this Reuters report from January 2024, VW has now put out the feelers to find alternative solid-state battery manufacturers, allegedly focusing on a well-established French outfit called Blue Solutions, which already produces solid-state batteries for Daimler electric buses. The challenge they bring to the table, though, is that their batteries currently take 4 hours to charge up, which is fine if your vehicle is parked up in a bus depot overnight, but not so good if you're on your way to your auntie's 90th birthday party and you're already half an hour late. A spokesperson for Blue Solutions told Reuters it was working on a passenger car battery with a charging time of 20 minutes, and that it was aiming to construct a gigafactory to build those batteries by 2029. But everyone says that, don't they? Meanwhile, Japanese behemoth Toyota, fresh from waving bye-bye to longtime chief and arch EV denier Akio Toyoda in January 2023, have now enthusiastically joined the race for EV domination. The company claims to have achieved a breakthrough in solid-state battery technology, enabling a driving range of more than 750 miles and a charging time of 10 minutes. Although anything approaching what you might describe as detail has not so far been forthcoming. Anyway, having promised these batteries by 2021 and then by 2023, Toyota now says they'll be producing the cells at scale by 2027 or 2028, which probably means 2029 or 2030. South Korean car giant Hyundai are right there in the mix too, working with US-based firm Solid Power on a solid-state battery setup that they say includes materials that can withstand not just high temperatures, but also very low temperatures, which I'm sure will come as very welcome news to those of you living in colder climes like Canada. They've also addressed one of the potential pitfalls of solid-state technology, which is the tendency for solid materials to expand and contract with large temperature changes, which in turn can cause damaging cracks in the battery's structure. Hyundai's system uses a fluid to apply constant pressure to each cell during charging and discharging to prevent deformation and maintain good surface contact and conductivity between the electrodes and the solid electrolyte. Sensors within the battery monitor temperature, pressure, and voltage, and an external controller regulates the whole thing and updates the vehicle or the charging device accordingly. Hyundai don't give any specific production timelines, but their press release states that Hyundai Motor Group accelerates development of next generation batteries, including solid state, aiming to produce 3.64 million EVs by 2030. Then there's the Chinese automaker NIO, which has been developing its own semi-solid-state battery with partner company WeLion for several years. In November 2023, NIO's chief executive, William Li, live-streamed a 14-hour, 650-mile road trip down the coast of China from Shanghai to Xiamen in a NIO ET7 sedan, apparently powered by a 150 kilowatt-hour version of the new battery. To give a bit of context, a 150 kilowatt-hour standard lithium-ion battery in the Rivian R1T pickup truck gives a range of 410 miles. Li was apparently quoted as saying, "This battery is currently the battery pack with the highest energy density in mass production in the world and has excellent safety performance." NIO reportedly received its first shipment of the batteries from WeLion in June 2023 and will begin true mass production in April 2024. You may also have heard of a company called ProLogium Technology, based just across the water from the Chinese mainland in Taiwan. ProLogium has been focused on solid-state battery research, development and manufacturing since 2006. And the company is arguably closer to market than any of its competitors. It has patented technologies that purportedly enable full charging in around 12 minutes and a driving range of up to 1,000 kilometres, which again we'll just have to take on face value until we see the real thing. That might not be all that far away though. ProLogium already has an automated pilot production line that's produced nearly 8,000 solid-state battery sample cells to global car manufacturers for testing and module development. In January 2022, ProLogium struck a multi-million euro deal with Mercedes-Benz with a view to getting solid-state batteries into their vehicle range by the second half of this decade. And in 2023, the company announced a 5.2 billion euro investment in a new purpose-built manufacturing facility to be built in France, with mass production expected to start there in 2027. Staying in Europe, a German company called High Performance Batteries, or HPB, was also blowing its own trumpet in October 2023, unveiling what it described as the world's first production-ready solid-state battery. According to the company's very slick website, their batteries have been independently evaluated to achieve more than 10,000 charging cycles with minimal degradation, represent a 50% reduction in environmental impact compared to current lithium-ion technology, and maintain a higher conductivity at minus 40 degrees Celsius than conventional liquid electrolytes can achieve at their optimum working temperature of plus 60 degrees Celsius. No doubt the good folks just down the road at Volkswagen will be beating a path to their door very soon, eh? There's a whole host of other companies around the globe working tirelessly to come up with their own solutions to the solid-state battery conundrum. One notable absentee from the frothy world of solid-state battery development, though, ironically enough, is Tesla Motors. I wonder if that's telling us something. I'll leave that open-ended question with you. And as always, if you've got news and views or actual industry experience of this particular technology, then why not jump down to the comment section below and share your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our Patreon supporters who enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of all my videos. If you'd like the chance to influence the direction of the channel through our Patreon chat forums and content polls, then why not pop over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to see how you can get involved. And if you don't want to miss out on notifications of new videos each week, then make sure you click on that subscribe button. It doesn't cost you a penny to do that, but it really does help us out here on YouTube. Dead easy to do, either by clicking on that link down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.